Good morning, and we are welcome to you. We continue from where we left off, and this is going to be a practical approach now. So we are going to do case-based thing. This is a 3.5-year-old boy born of non-continuous marriage. He comes with yellow color of skin and eyes, noted since the past 1 year. 3.5 years. Yellow color eyes and skin noticed in past 1 year. There is no high color bleeding. There is no bleeding. There is no fever. There is no joint pain. No rash. No blood transfusion. This is the history that we have found. Start thinking what this could be. What is the kind of jaundice? Obviously he has jaundice. Unconjugated. Why is saying this is unconjugated?
No school color.
No school
color?
No high color urine. So high color urine would be conjugated. This is no high color urine, so this is unconjugated jaundice. Okay. So this is indirect jaundice. Now we've been having this indirect jaundice for a year. What does that suggest? Obstruction would have been conjugated. Hemolysis. Why are you thinking of hemolysis?
I was in that indirect hemolysis, that's all. Liver problems.
Okay, can't it mean that the liver is not conjugated? So it could be both. Either the RBCs are getting hemolyzed or the liver is not conjugated. Yeah, so either the liver is not conjugating or the RBCs are getting hemolyzed. If there is hemolysis, there is no blood transfusion. Why is he not getting anything? Enzymatic defect of what?
Glucose.
Just explain the enzyme. Don't tell me the name. Just explain which enzyme. What is that enzyme doing?
Converting
unconjugated to conjugated.
So the enzyme that converts from unconjugated to conjugated, that enzyme is present in the liver. Now why should that suddenly that enzyme decide I will not function after 2.5 years of age? If that enzyme had a problem, it should have been from birth. That child is already in 2.5 years of age and now he is having that problem. So now it came up. So, okay, you're correct. One is the enzyme. There is an enzyme problem, conjugation is not taking place. If it is hemolysis, he's not requiring blood transfusion. Then what kind of hemolysis? Hereditary spherocytosis was said. But why hereditary spherocytosis is not causing any problem? So there is production, but there is destruction. So production is compensating. Yeah, so this is what is happening. Hemolysis without anemia. What is happening? Destruction is taking place, but bone marrow is compensating. That's why anemia is not occurring. Now, why are these RBCs getting destroyed?
Abnormal shape.
So there is hereditary spherocytosis. So abnormal shape. What else?
Defective RBCs.
What kind of defect?
Shape.
One is a shape.
Hemoglobin.
Sickle cell anemia will not come with indirect jaundice going on for a year. It will come with crisis to you. Sudden crisis of anemia, sudden crisis of jaundice.
Fetal hemoglobin.
Why should there be fetal hemoglobin? Like thalassemia. Thalassemia is transfusion dependent anemia. Thalassemia means every 21 days I go to the hospital to get a transfusion.
Thalassemia
minor will not have a deficiency. They will be like us. They will even have iron deficiency. So maybe something like a thalassemia, but not exactly thalassemia major. So some combination thalassemia. Maybe it's sickle cell. Sickle cell can come like this. So it's neither sickling, neither thalassemia. They just come as hemolysis. So maybe there is a either the RBCs are, this is what we discussed, either they are normal and conjugation not taking place or RBCs are informed and there is increased hemoglobin. Conjugation of indirect bilirubin not taking place is called as Krigler-Najar. Now Krigler-Najar are of two types. Both of them come to your jaundice in newborn period and they cause conjunctivitis if untreated. So they should, by now their child should be mentally retarded if untreated. So this is not something that will come at 2.5 years. So this is no good. So point against is these two things. So what is the problem? Membrane defect. Spherocytosis, elliptocytosis. Somebody mentioned G6PD. G6PD would not come as jaundice for a year. It would come as acute hemolysis. Somebody gave him primapril, that child went and hemolysis. Thalassemia would be transfusion dependent. Because what is happening here in thalassemia, the bone marrow is not functioning. What is happening in the bone marrow? RBCs are being formed but destroyed in the bone marrow itself. So this is where thalassemia comes into the picture. Your thalassemia is not because there is no anemia. So what we are thinking is maybe hereditary spherocytosis, elliptocytosis, or a combination thalassemia like a sickle cell. So what would you expect on examination? So this is what he came to us. He came to us with just indirect jaundice for 1 year. We have not gone into examination. We came to a diagnosis by our history. What would we expect on examination? We would expect a spleen. What else?
Spleen and liver.
Liver.
Why should we expect a liver?
Extrapapillary
hematopoiesis comes when there is anemia. He is not anemia. Maybe he would have anemia on examination. Maybe the pallor would be there, hemoglobin maybe around 8, 9, 10. That would be another thing. But he is not transfusion dependent anemia. Yes, so we may get something like hemolytic platelet. Frontal boxing axillary prominence. We may see anemia, we may see a spleen. So what we would get is maybe splenomegaly, hemolytic platelet, maybe hepatomegaly, pallor. Why don't we get hepatomegaly? Not because of extramedullary. If we have a hereditary spherocytosis, why should there be a liver? There is destruction of the RBCs. RBCs are getting neutralized. Bilirubin is forming. This bilirubin forms stones. Gallstones. Bilirubin gallstones. Adults we get cholesterol gallstones. Children we get bilirubin gallstones. That gallstones can give you hepatomegaly. So maybe hepatomegaly in a hereditary spherocytosis.
Only gallstone will give you hepatomegaly. Biliary duct is obstructed.
Yes. They can get, yeah, but they can get jaundice with hepatomegaly. So not usually, you would get a jaundice, direct jaundice with hepatomegaly. So maybe we would pick this up, or maybe it would not be there. Again, if it's a sickle cell, hepatomegaly will be there. So maybe we would get this.
So I think this will come up only, case will come up only after chronic anemia.
Yeah, so there may be a chronic anemia of 10 years. Not enough to cause him to go into transfusion dependence, but something which is chronic there. So other areas of the bone have to expand. So that's the cause of your hemolytic disease. So on examination, this child has pallor. He has jaundice. He has frontoparietal bossing and pallor prominence. He has pneumohepatomegaly. Other systems are not. Just as what we are expecting. Now, how do you want to investigate?
Thank you.
Thank you. What do you want to do with the peripheral smear? Okay, so one is peripheral smear, look for spherocytosis.
Reticulum will have to be.
Okay, we want to do a reticulum. So we want to see whether there is hemolytic.
Even peripheral smear, that is spherocytosis.
So we want to do peripheral smear, we want to do reticulum. Do you want to do hemolytic fragility?
Hemolytic fragility, yeah, it will be.
Yeah, so we want to see hereditary spherocytosis, so we want to do osmotic fragility. Do you want to do electrophoresis?
No,
so first it will have anemia. So we want to do that. So since there is membrane defect problem, we will do hemogram, we will do peripheral smear, we will do a retic count, we will do osmotic fragility and electrophoresis. Now what is expected out of this? We said peripheral smear, spherocytes, hemogram, they show little anemia, may not show complete. Reticulocytes will be increased, osmotic fragility will be abnormal. electrophoresis of its sickle cell will be abnormal. So this child does have anemia. He has an increased MCH. One way of picking up hereditary spirochetosis is look at the indices. MCV, MCH and MCHC. Hereditary spirochetosis is the only condition in which you get increased MCH because of the membrane problem. So you will see increased MCH. There will be a high retic count. There are spherocytes and peripheries here. Increased osmotic pressure. And if all this is negative, then you do electrophoresis to look for fetal hemoglobin to make a diagnosis of thalassemia or fetal thal to look for HBS also. So we came to a diagnosis of hereditary spherocytosis just on that history of 1 year indirect jaundice. Okay, we did not even have to examine this child. We knew right from the beginning that this is an RBC syndrome defect or it's a sickle cell.
We have to screen every
Yes, we are coming to that. So now if you diagnose hereditary spherocytosis, how is this inherited?
Autosomal?
When we talk about recessive, we mean two genes are abnormal. Both genes, this is like a something that comes as we can't call it 100%, but something that you can keep in mind. Recessive means two genes are abnormal. Two genes, both the genes are abnormal means it's a severe problem. So any recessive problem should start right from birth. The thalassemia starts right from birth. Other recessive disorders start right from birth. Dominant means one gene is abnormal, one gene is normal. So that other gene is safeguarding you. So dominant problems come to you as adults or little older children. Why are we screening parents? Because we are expecting them to have a spleen, maybe have hereditary spherocytosis. But they are still asymptomatic. So if they are affected and the child is affected, condition is autosomal dominant. Recessive parents could be normal. Child is affected and affected severely. Dominant, both are affected. Penetrance may be different. Father may be less, child may be more. Usually disease of older age. So this is autosomal dominant. So we have to screen. How do we screen? Look for the spleen in both the parents and look for gallstones. Because by the time they are parents, they may be having gallstones. So ultrasound to look for gallstones and look for the spleen.
Certainly it is necessary to remove spleen as well as gallbladder together.
Yeah, now when would you do a splenectomy in such a child?
Hypersplenism.
Symptoms of hypersplenism. The symptoms of hypersplenism. Or he becomes transfusion dependent. He's not transfusion dependent yet. But the spleen keeps on increasing, goes into hypersplenism, then he becomes transfusion dependent. That's the time you would want to remove of the spleen. So obviously when you do splenectomy, there are two thoughts here. Some people advise removing the gallbladder at the same time. Whereas some people say don't remove the gallbladder till he's symptomatic for gallstones. But most of the people remove the gallbladder at the time of splenectomy. How would you, so this child's hemoglobin is 8, WBC count is normal, VEGIC is 5%, there are spherocyte, OFT is abnormal, he is hereditary spherocytosis. Now how would you manage such a child?
Platelet
count is normal.
Why WBC
is higher? WBC of 12,200 for a child of 3 years is normal. So how would you manage this child? What would you tell them?
Not to give iron.
Yeah.
Okay, you're correct. Not to give iron. One, you need to give them folic acid. Why do we need to be? Because there is hemolysis taking place, there is increased cell turnover. So they utilize that folic acid very rapidly. So you need to give them folic acid, otherwise they will end up with megaloblastic.
Hydroxyurea. Also,
that is later. Then you give them iron, you do not give them. Why? Because whatever hemolysis is taking place is taking place in the body. So iron is getting deposited in the body. They are not losing iron anywhere from the body. So that iron can be reutilized. So you don't need to give them iron, just give them folic acid.